Thank you, Mike, and good morning, everyone, for our early Saturday morning gathering here. We're going to spend the next hour and quarter hour and 18 minutes, according to the clock, discussing the United States and the world, or the world and the United States, which, of course, is a very much too much of a global spread, so to speak, but really talking about attitudes, opinions, images, stereotypes, animosities, where we are and where we go from here. And as a journalist, when a journalist gets a good story, a good anecdote, he constantly repeats it. And those of you who have been to some council sessions that I have moderated before may recall that I usually like to quote the great Spanish philosopher Ortega y Gasset, one of the great thinkers of the 20th century, who summed up his entire philosophical research as to what the meaning of philosophy is with a simple phrase, "I am what I am plus my circumstances," which I think is very good because it's a good soundbite philosophy, but there's a lot of depth in that short phrase. In other words, we are what we are as the United States today, plus our circumstances in the world, which go far beyond the immediate problem in Afghanistan or Iraq. How do we relate with other people? To speak about this today and to discuss this, we're very honored to have Ernesto Zedillo here to my left. We all know his role in Mexico as president of Mexico in the 1990s. He is currently director of the Center for the Study of Globalization at Yale and has come down today to share his experience and thoughts with us. To his left is Rami Khouri, a familiar face here at the Council. Rami, I've known for years as a colleague, as a journalist, as an editor, first based in Jordan, and now more recently he's the executive editor of the Daily Star in Beirut, Lebanon, and a very good observer of the Middle East scene, which is certainly a very current issue. Yoichi Funabashi is another well-known expert, chief diplomatic correspondent for Asahi Shimbun in Japan, but stationed in Washington for many, many years. He's the chief, as I said, the chief diplomatic correspondent and commentator for that leading newspaper. And he'll give us perspective from Japan and from Asia. And Gianni Riotta is a commentator from Italy, based here in New York City, Gianni, but you're writing for Corriere della Sera, lecturing, other writings too, and very insightful on European affairs and the United States. So we're going to start off really without any formal opening statements, but more just a discussion. I would turn first of all to President Zedillo here, both in your capacity from your background of a Latin American perspective, but also now at Yale running the Globalization Center. When you look at the international reaction, the critical reaction to the United States, how do you assess this? Is this a passing phenomenon, or is this attitude itself something lasting that we have to take very seriously in the United States?
Well, Garrick, you started this session by quoting Ortega y Gasset. Let me try the same.
Okay.
Ortega y Gasset liked to say, "Substance is in the form." You know, it's not only how you present, substance is determined also in the way in which you present things. And I think a good part of what we have seen over the last year and a half has to do with it. However, there is a fundamental substantive aspect of this crisis of the international system, which I dare to call a crisis. It is not only how you present things. I think there's a fundamental thing that actually Henry Kissinger brought to our attention a year ago, sometime in the summer, when he said that a preemptive war on Iraq probably would bring about a change in the international order by giving up, by throwing away something that had been well established since 1648, you know, the concept of Westphalian sovereignty. The United States was going to carry out a rather revolutionary step. That's the way in which he presented that. And I think what we are seeing is the consequence of that. The world is not yet clear what's behind this new grand strategy that has been put forward, an exercise by Washington in recent months, not only because of the striking nature of this action in Iraq, but also because the foreign policy has been sending rather contradictory signals. Not only since last year, but I would say in the aftermath of 9/11. Because actually what happened after 9/11 is that the United States presented a very multilateralistic face. The US went to Doha and pushed and championed the launching of the new round of trade liberalization. President Bush went to Monterrey, Mexico, and announced something that for a long time this country hadn't done, increased 50% US foreign aid. President Bush went to the UN and gave a very nice conciliatory speech saying we will come to the Security Council. And furthermore, he announced that the United States was going back to UNESCO. More recently, we have heard other very encouraging decisions of international cooperation. But at the same time, we had seen the excesses of evil speech. We have heard the June 4, I guess, West Point speech, and of course, all the process that led to the Iraqi war. And in between, we had the National Security Strategy document, in which you have the perfect case for multilateralism explained, but also in a very brutal way, the new doctrine of preemptive action put forward. So I guess the world is concerned because this very basic principle of international law seemingly has been discarded by the United States. And at the same time, there are a number of actions that would suggest that there is still hope that the U.S. Will pursue a different kind of process. And of course, the most encouraging aspect in that respect is what we just saw 2 days ago in Jordan.
Yes.
You know, the U.S. really, President Bush, championing the roadmap for peace in the Middle East.
Well, your key word there is concern, but you seem to be saying the jury is still out despite all the waves of criticism that we've been hearing. There is still a hope out there that the United States may come around in a more multilateral way, as we've seen in the Middle East. Let's move on now to Rami, because you're coming from the Middle East. The recent polls, we're familiar with that, the Pew Trust and others have shown how the support for the U.S. has plummeted, and in the Middle East has hit, in the Arab world, it's hit rock bottom. A, is this lasting? B, the implications of that, and with events such as the recent meeting in the Middle East and the Bush initiative there, which is a very energetic one, is that going to alleviate that in any sense? What's your reading vis-a-vis the U.S.?
Thank you. thank you to the Council for having me. It's always an honor and a pleasure to be here. And I'm glad the New Jersey team won last night, so everybody's much more relaxed in New York City this morning. that's a nice sign. I think we really can look at the situation and learn about two things. We can learn about the U.S. and we can also learn about ourselves in the Arab world. And I think when you look at the Arab world, you really have to differentiate between three, I think, significant elements that are there today. And this is probably true in any society. You have the regimes, the political leaderships in charge. And in the Middle East, all of these were non-elected and are still relatively non-accountable. So they're self-perpetuating regimes. Then you have the political activist level of people in NGOs and political parties and labor unions, whatever. And then you have the mass of the citizenry. And these are three very different actors reacting in very different ways to American power, to American policy, to American values, to all kinds of, all different aspects of the United States. So I think it's the most important thing is to keep this nuanced perception of both of ourselves in the Arab world and of the United States. Having said that, I would say that to answer your question directly, the strong anti-American criticism that is constantly shown in the polls, and the Pew poll showed it most recently, is very clearly a function of the policy of the United States and the the condition of the people in the Arab world together. Mm-hmm. Being anti-American is neither a function of something in our genes or in our water. It's something that is a function of how people see themselves in the Middle East and how they react to American policy. And then I think you have to look at two things, the style and the substance of American policy, both of which are very problematic for most people in the Arab world, for most people at the citizen level. Most Arab governments were either openly or quietly with the United States in what it was doing in Iraq. I would say the majority of them were pretty happy to see the U.S. do what it did, but most Arab people and political activists, I think, were very critical. So it can be undone. This anti-American sentiment can be reversed if two things happen. If American policy becomes more, is perceived to be more fair and more rooted in international legitimacy in the eyes of people in the Arab world, and if the people of the Arab world themselves find themselves in a situation where they have less reason to keep expressing grievances against the United States. And one of the critical elements in this situation, and this is something that I think Americans are particularly bad at understanding, the critical element is historical memory. The United States doesn't have much history as a nation. It's only 230 years old, but it has even less historical memory. Americans are extremely forgiving and pragmatic, and you beat up people and then you help rebuild them and give them money, and it's an extraordinary part of American culture and policy. From the Arab perspective in the Middle East, it's very different. We're still, you know, we're still angry at Europe for the Crusades, but this is a reality. This is a real part of life. So what people, you know, one of the reasons people in the Arab world especially are so angry these days and frightened of what the United States is doing is because they see, when they hear Colin Powell say that he wants to reshape the Middle East, they see 1920. And the experience in the Arab world from 1920 till 2003 has been a rather catastrophic one for most ordinary people. Well, catastrophic may be too strong a word, but the average Arab is in great angst. They have real problems of domestic autocracy, of humiliation with Israel, of foreign power intervention, of environmental distress, economic regression, lack of democracy. There's all kinds of stresses that bear down on the average person. And they see this in the modern historical context, and they see what the United States is doing now is both a perpetuation and a reaffirmation and expansion of that modern historical legacy with European colonialism. So it's a combination of American policy, the condition of people in the Arab world, historical trends, and there's great concern and anger, I think, among the majority of people in the region, and this is something we'll have to keep monitoring as we go along.
You raise a very important point there, which I really hadn't focused on, and that is that it's not just a factor of what the United States does, either in substance or in form, but it's also how people in other countries or regions react to that, their concern. It's what that the American action does in terms of triggering their own self-image of power or impotence. And the two are constantly going together, which brings us to Europe in a way, Johnny. As an Italian, neither a German nor a Frenchman, you can give us a continental view of what's going on there. I just cite two things. First of all, we talk about how the support for the United States or admiration for the U.S. has plummeted overseas. We know those figures. But those same polls ask what Americans think of countries overseas. To wit, February 9, 2002, U.S. opinion of France, positive 79%. 1 year later, 29%. U.S. opinion of Germany a year ago, 83% approval. Today, 44%. So we're talking about a two-way street, which is going here. But give us the
first of all,
one-way street from Italy.
I'll give you a disclaimer that I was born and raised in Sicily, so I don't know whether I qualify as a continent. I don't want people then to get mad at me. My column on Corriere della Sera on transatlantic relationship is called Titanic. I started in 1994, and people ask me why. Mm-hmm. And I always say because it's difficult to communicate between Europe and the United States, so we better start it from scratch. I think that in the past few months, so many misconceptions made a few people quite rich, but our wisdom a little poorer. First of all, Europeans are not from Venus at all. Trust me, come to Europe, have a stroll on any main square, you will see that we are not from Venus. If you go to the millions of Americans that demonstrated for peace, and you tell them that they are from Mars, they'll get quite upset. And as you know, peaceniks can be quite violent when they want. So don't do that. Don't do that. It's not a problem at all of values. I don't think that is like us versus them or Europe versus the United States. It's a matter of interest. It's a matter of interest. I don't know if any of you have read the book by Dominique de Villepin, the French foreign minister, on Napoleon. It's the closer thing that you can read to the kind of military rhetoric that comes out these days from the Pentagon. Mm-hmm. It's exactly the same style. We are a great nation, we will have a great army, and we will win because our great fathers always won, and our blood, our DNA is a winning DNA. It's exactly the same. Why was Villepin so strongly opposed to the war? Because President Chirac and Mr. Villepin believe that it's not in the interest of France, mainly, and secondly, of the European Union to join that enterprise. So if we can really, the philosopher, since we're talking about philosopher, Occam would say, use the razor to shave off unnecessary entities. It's not a clash of values. Is a clash of interest. And in a way, this makes it a little easier to solve, but of course, a little more a little more difficult. The problem is that the animosity against the United States started before the war, when President Clinton was in the White House and Jospin was ruling France. His foreign minister, Vedrine, first spoke of the hyperpuissance, the superpower of the United States. And Beauvais was already smashing McDonald's all over Europe. The point is that we should address, can the interest of the United States and Europe be reconciled, or they are on a smashing course that there is nothing to do about it? I think that we should work on reconciling them. I think that when we face the global problem, there is no global problem that we can solve without the United States and Europe talking. Think about Kyoto. The rhetoric goes, the United States didn't sign Kyoto, Europe signed Kyoto, and they did. Only three countries in Europe are actually meeting the standards of Kyoto: Germany, France, and Great Britain. It is true that they are the economic superpower, but Italy, Spain, Greece, all the other are out. So how does it match? Again, it's a clash of rhetorics more than a clash of really. Both Europe and the United States are not respecting the Kyoto standards. Our point and what we should try to work is that if we can put Europe and the United States together again, I don't think that the style mattered that much. I don't think that the Rumsfeld starts asking please and thank you. Actually, the transatlantic dialogue will make progress. I think that we should meet on real issues. And what I like to warn our mostly, I guess, American audience is that things are changed very, very, very fast. Last year, I told the writer Umberto Eco, my old friend and mentor, we need an army as European if we want our voice to be heard in the world. And he told me, how many years have you lived in the United States? You're like a Marine. We don't need an army. This is crazy. 2 weeks ago, he wrote a column on La Repubblica, one of the most respected European dailies, saying, we need an army. How can our voice be heard? And the fact that Umberto Eco, as my friend discussed, the fact that Umberto Eco is now advocating a European army is a huge, huge, huge change in his attitude. People write me and email me. Well, you always said that the United States is as an unmatching military power. But if we join Germany and the Great Britain and France and Russia, can't we match them? And this gives me the creeps, because 5 years ago, nobody would have thought of that. So please, and I'm done. Don't think is a match of values. Read the speech that Senator Kennedy gave against the war at the Senate, and read the editorial of Le Monde. One of whom, I mean, either Kennedy copied from Le Monde or Le Monde copied from Kennedy, but they are exactly the same. They believe in the same set of values and perspective on the war. So it's not a match of values, it's a match of interest, more difficult.
Thank you. Well, we're going to come back because there's some very important points in Europe that you raised there. And one of the things that I picked up in your comments was what was alluded to earlier by Rami, that is, it's not just the European attitude vis-a-vis the policy of the U.S., but the Europeans now, in Umberto Eco, examining this issue of power in the world and how that should be manifested, in his case, through military power as well. Yoichi, let's turn over to Asia, because the importance of, obviously, Japan and China, whether China and the UN debate over Iraq and where we are right now, we haven't heard that much from Asia in terms of attitudes towards the United States, the Iraq policy, and George Bush. How do you assess it?
I think that Asians also very much worried about the Iraq campaign and its implication for the North Korean issue. Perhaps they're more interested, intensely interested in the North Korean nuclear issue than Iraq issue, for instance. They are now really examining very closely that the possible lessons which North Korea has drawn from the U.S. attack on Iraq, and perhaps that is extremely undesirable one, that with the only fully fledged nuclear power status, can you be safe with that the military strike from the United States? So, in other words, that it's a Pakistani formula. But we have been talking about the rhetoric and style versus substance. But in terms of style and rhetoric, with regard to that North Korean policy, at least approach, the United States is adamant that it should be multilateral. It should be based on multilateral approach. Even though many of that the Northeast Asian countries and the East Asian countries as well, I want to see the United States enter into negotiation with Pyongyang directly on bilateral basis to defuse the issue, to make a deal. So in other words, it looks like that the United States is pursuing that multilateral approach unilaterally. You know, you have to be very, very careful of the rhetoric as well as substance. But overall, I think that Asians also, governments, very much worried, concerned about that the neoconservatives accruing more and more influence over policy in Washington, even though they still seem to consist not large and a pervasive level. Numbers are very much limited, but still they seem to enjoy exorbitantly influential influence over the policy making. This doctrine of preemption, empty strike, and gleeful bashing, United Nations bashing, with us or against us, those rhetoric are really very much disconcerting to America's allies and friends. And they wonder very hard whether this is just the transient nature in the direction of the wind, or it is becoming to be a more permanent texture of American politics and diplomacy. The jury is still out. I think it's still too early to tell. And after all, we'll have that, the presidential election every 4 years. So that's perhaps the biggest, safety valve for the world governance, perhaps. But the Neocons influence perhaps should not be limited to themselves, a small numbers, but it can be more pervasive because due to that enormous impact which that 9/11 has had on that American psyche. And this propulsion of that 9/11 and impact on the politics and diplomacy will remain to be there. I think the world will be in deep trouble.
Let's pick up on this point, and anybody can join in before we go to the questions with the audience. On this question of the unilateralism versus multilateralism, these are two long words which are bandied about all the time, but I'm getting some mixed signals here of perceptions as to where you really think the United States and the Bush administration, at least, has stepped off the deep end, or into the deep end, and saying this is unilateralism, or whether there are examples, such as in the Korea issue, where they're approaching or wanting to embrace a more multinational approach. I mean, from your point of view, is this becoming a unilateral nation, or is this just was Iraq an exception?
No, I think right now, at least my interpretation, is that the U.S. administration is trying to play by double standards. I think the grand strategy is not to say we are going to go totally unilateral, but rather, when we believe it is necessary, convenient, we'll go unilateral. And when we need the multilateral system, we'll use the multilateral system. The big question here is whether this double standards strategy is really sustainable, is durable, is wise, and whether, in fact, it will not prove counterproductive. From my perspective, it's not sustainable. Every time the U.S. finds it necessary to go unilateral, the damage will be very significant. Every time it will take more and more to do damage control. Every time the U.S. will find it increasingly difficult to have allies for new international endeavors, and it will encounter more aggressive, rather either open or cover the position to whatever the U.S. Finds it necessary to pursue its foreign policy objectives. I think that's a fundamental problem right now with Washington that I have, that they believe that the double standards strategy is sustainable. I think it is not sustainable. And it will start triggering, you know, these ideas that, after all, the unipolar moment is just a moment. That naturally, if the U.S. pursues this aggressive unipolarity, a new balance will have to be restored somehow. Mm-hmm. Right now, what the world is seeing is what you were saying. You know, people, not only Umberto Eco's, but if you remember a month ago, Fabius writing this long article saying we have to arm to counter, which is absolutely crazy because it's spending money when we need to spend the money on something else.
Other views on this?
I think from the Middle East perspective, I would say a couple of things. It's interesting that not everybody in the Middle East is criticizing the United States. I mean, you have a lot of people, well, you have some people in the Arab world who want the U.S. to do what it's doing. I mean, they're a minority, but they want the U.S. to be more involved. But a lot of people want the U.S. to, they don't mind American unilateralism if it is consistent. I mean, this is one of the great problems we have with the U.S. It's not so much unilateralism, but it's the double standard. So if you're going to marshal an armada to attack an Arab country to implement UN resolutions, in theory, there's no problem with that if you do it for all UN resolutions. But if you're selective in which resolutions you want to implement, then there's a problem. If you're selective in how you're going to use your power to make the UN relevant, as President Bush has said, We have no problem with that if you apply it to all UN resolutions. Again, if you want to marshal an armada to fight tyranny, do it against all tyrants, but don't be so selective. So you have a lot of people in the Middle East, actually, if you listen carefully, they're asking the U.S. to get involved more, especially in Arab-Israeli peacemaking. Everybody, at least the regimes, have been telling the U.S., please, get involved. Don't pull back like George Bush wanted to do when he first came to power. They're asking the U.S. to be involved, but to do it on the basis of a combination of legitimacy, legality, and fairness that has long been absent from American policy in the Middle East. So I think that the question is very much about the nature of American unilateralism. The reality historically is that in the Middle East, we've had thousands of years of experience of dealing with these powers and these armies coming from overseas. And you know, Emperor Trajan and the Emperor Hadrian and the second century AD were doing the same thing, bringing their armies and redrawing borders and reshaping the Middle East. And many people in the Middle East were adopting Greek and Roman names, and others were fighting them. And the same thing is going on today. So part of the problem is, axiomatically, you're going to get opposition to any kind of power coming at you from abroad. So the U.S., I think we have to be fair that if China were the great power and was doing this, you'd have the same kind of opposition to some extent. People are always going to fight this kind of power. And if you look at how it's human nature to an extent also, when we were children or as parents now, if you look at how children react to their parents, when parents are telling their children to do something that's good for them, the children often resist it. even if they know what their parents are telling them is good for them. And there's an element of this, no matter what the U.S. tells us. If the U.S. comes to us and says it wants to give us democracy, prosperity, stability, and peace, you're going to have a lot of people in the Middle East who are going to say, no, we don't want it because this is a neocolonial plot. And this is part of the inherent problem. So I raise these issues because there are many nuanced dimensions to this. The answer, the antidote to these problems is in the American tradition of constitutionalism, equality, the rule of law. So if the U.S. were to act unilaterally or multilaterally, applying to the Middle East and to the world the same values that it has applied to itself, then I think there'd be very few problems. But the double standards that the U.S. applies are so grievous that they elicit this kind of reaction. And the last point I'd make is that the fear of many people in the region now is that the U.S.'s policy, the traditional policies that the U.S. used, say, of containment against, say, the Soviet Union or Iraq or Iran, containment as an American policy principle has been replaced, many people fear, by cloning, that they want to turn the people, the countries of the Middle East, into mini Americas. They want to clone their values onto us. And even though they're great values, that the fact that the U.S. seems to be trying to impose them by military force and regime change is eliciting massive resistance, and we can watch this happening slowly in Iraq and at a wider public opinion level throughout the region. Yoichi.
You cannot just deny that element of double standard applied by the United States, and it's very much troubling. On the surface, yes, in some cases that the U.S. Performance and policy making is on the verge of double standard. But at the same time, I think perhaps that the problem is much deeper than if that problem is that U.S. applying double standard, then it's U.S. problem. Maybe easier for us to solve that issues. But I think that it's much deeper. First, I think perhaps that derives from the perception gap of the threat between America and America's allies. As the 9/11 and post-9/11 impact still is so much poignant here in the United States, I do not think that America's allies do share to a similar extent that the threat perception. And they do not want to share that, perhaps, in some cases. And I think that the America's allies are more worried about that the reactions of that the United States, including that preemptive action and the others. Also, I think compounding the problem is that emerging tremendous gap of the military capability between America's allies, and it has increasingly rendered that America's allies' military power relevant in forming the alliance and pursuing the alliance policy and addressing that the threat. Even that the United Kingdom was sort of belittled by Rumsfeld just prior to that the attack on Baghdad. Also, I think that the allies and America are perhaps divergent, have started to divergent the views of international order vision, including the role of the United Nations. So, if you think of all those the more fundamental issues that we confront, I do not think that the problem is just a double standard that the United States applying.
Very briefly, sometimes this double standard is really harmful for the United States. And I don't know how many people in the American public opinion make the point. The World Criminal Court would be incredibly convenient when you have to put to trial Saddam Hussein, Uday, Hassan, whatever the United States can catch. Being within Kyoto would be great to dispute, we can't match Kyoto, but you cannot match Kyoto at the same time. All this, Guantanamo. I don't know the kind of intelligence that the United States is getting out of those guys at Guantanamo, but it should be superb. Because if it's not superb, it can't match the public relation debacle that Guantanamo is. You go lecture to any public school in Europe these days, talking against Castro, and there will be always a smart kid raising his hand and saying, yeah, fine with Castro. Castro is something from the past, but what about Guantanamo? And what you are saying about memory, old memory, I come from Sicily, so I share your old memory, unfortunately. memory. I mean, my grandparents were arguing about things happened 5 centuries ago, like it happened 5 weeks ago. But the memory is changing a lot. Sympathy that Israel used to have with my generation, with my father's generation, is now lost with kids that are 18, 19, 20, because they sympathize with the suffering of the Palestinians. And so everything, all the kind of sets that we have is very, very different. One mistake that the administration is making is that they say, well, we have Italy, Great Britain, Spain on our side, and France and other countries against us. If you look at the numbers of the public opinion in Italy, in Spain, in England, they are exactly in Poland. Mm-hmm. Poland was with the United States, but the public opinion of Poland was very, very much against the war.
You mentioned 2 points there. When we're going to go to questions in just a second, but the thing that struck me since the word memory has come up a number of occasions here, and we may not have that deep a memory in American culture. When I was growing up as a teenager in Chicago and very much interested in international affairs, one of the words or phrases that came up was the title of a book called The Ugly American. And few people really understood what it was about. It wasn't about Americans in Bermuda shorts and Hawaiian shirts going around the world and not speaking the language and just asking whether the water was safe to drink. It was a story, remember, about American efforts in Southeast Asia to fight the early expansion of communism, and it was about the ambassador and aid programs and things like this. And the basic thesis was that there was built into this well-intentioned effort a certain naivete, a certain lack of understanding of languages and cultures, and a certain assumption that everything was going to work out right because America knew best. And that was translated into this phrase, the ugly American. So in a way, my question is, or the point is this something that goes with the territory? Is this something that isn't really new at all? It's been with us for decades. A similar dynamic is at work here if you are the main superpower, as the United States was in post-World War II world in the 1950s. And we are in some sense in a similar situation here today.
May I disagree on a point, on the point of memory? Any of you comes from the south of the United States?
Oh, many.
Okay. Tell me about the Confederate war flag. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? Actually, this is a live issue today. People are voting, referendum, marching on the street for something that happened over a year ago. So I think that is in this country, memory doesn't go back to the crusade, but it goes back as much as they can. And sometimes even people say, well, I come from this country, I come from their country. The interesting point is the follow-up. My father says, how come the American entered Palermo in 1943, and 48 hours the radio was functioning, water was running, and they gave me a job, and in Baghdad, 6 years later, they cannot do the same. In Afghanistan, a lot of people sort of sympathized with the overthrowing of the regime, of the Taliban regime, but then when you read stories about Afghanistan, it's really, things are pretty much where they were. So the problem is that why this country cannot go on with the follow-up like they used to, beat up people and then rebuild the economy like you were saying.
Well, then we're going to go to questions right now, because I think we've laid the, we have another 35 minutes or so. Lots of questions. There are microphones here. Please identify yourself. And I neglected to say earlier, this is being conducted under council rules, not for attribution. But hey, what we're saying is what we all want to share with each other anyway. Start with the gentleman right there. Please, your name, hometown, and question.
Ted Van Dyke, Seattle. All of the gentlemen on the podium share one thing, which do most foreign nationals at this point. They come from countries which are weak economically, weak militarily, suffering from ineffectual and oftentimes corrupt leadership. An American president has the first responsibility.
Oh, Japan. You're talking about Japan. And
I would say ineffectual, not corrupt.
Oh.
Okay. The point is this. the point is this. No, this is a serious question.
Yeah, go ahead.
The president of the United States has the first responsibility to care for the safety and security of the American people.
Mm-hmm.
That's where he begins. Sometimes you use multilateral means. Sometimes you will have to use unilateral means. But I would think that the most illustrative example of where we now stand is the one of the North Korean example, where North Korea's neighbors wish the United States to take a bilateral approach because they don't want to go to the trouble of joining in a serious multilateral approach. So we can't have it both ways. If you want the United States to lead, other countries also must be strong and be willing to lead. That's my point, and also a question.
Yes, I think in Northeast Asia particularly, it still is in a rule of jungle, and the U.S. Military commitment and presence is the most sought after, even including China. So nobody wants to see the United States withdrawing all those troops stationed in there. And certainly would live with the United States for a long time to come, as far as that the particularly the North Korean nuclear threat will remain to be there. And I think that's one of the reasons why Japanese Prime Minister Koizumi has supported that the United States war on Iraq so strongly, even though 65% of the Japanese public express their opposition to war. I think I think in large part that the consideration to North Korea has been a critical element of his decision on Iraq war. I think that the U.S. If the United States would be very much drawn to the war of attrition, war against the terror, I think that worries America's allies. If that would sow the seed of of its undoing, then I think that could be very much detrimental to the world peace and the U.S. alliance system. It could cause self-fulfilling prophecy of clashes of civilization. So I think it's not anti-American sentiment. I think more concern. I think that more visible, particularly among the policymakers.
Yes. Well, I think we forgot to establish something very clearly from the very beginning, and that is that nobody, at least in this kind of meeting, should be expected to believe that the President of the United States has to act because of a philanthropic or altruistic interest vis-a-vis the rest of the world. I was a president, and of course, whenever I was asked what was the motive of my decisions, I would say, first of all, above all, the national interest of the country that I represent. So it would be naive, idiotic to expect that the President of the United States will act because of global altruism rather than the national interest of the United States. I think the rest of the world understands, and particularly after 9/11, that the priority number one in this country is national security. I don't think there is any doubt about it. But having said that, what the country does, what the rest of the world sometimes doesn't understand, are certain policies that are not evidently connected to the national security of the United States. I think everybody is so happy that we don't have a Hussein around. There is no question about it. But people are still having some problem in understanding what was the relationship between Hussein and the national security of the United States. And this sense of doubt is increasing every day, because after all, we have found that the powerful Hussein army did not exist. Somebody told me, well, that army would have been defeated even by the French army. And second, you know, all these questions about weapons of mass destruction. So I think there has been a lack of transparency of what is the grand strategy in the pursuit of this Iraqi campaign. And I think, you know, as a friend, I said that this is going to be an increasingly difficult political problem in this country, because the only thing worse than managing a very poor underdeveloped country is to manage an oil very poor underdeveloped country. And you will see the consequences of that.
Let's just get a few questions and a number of hands up. Let's go right over here, the gentleman right there. Yes, you, sir.
Daniel Dresner, University of Chicago, Chicago, Illinois. Most of the conversation has been about security matters. I'm curious, as President Zedillo acknowledged, the U.S. has tried to reach out in terms of economics on a more multilateral approach, trying to restart the Doha round, push a free trade area of the Americas. Most recently, President Bush has proposed a Middle Eastern free trade area. I'm wondering, do you think those steps will help to at least ameliorate some of what's happened in the security realm, or is it simply, in the eyes of foreigners, two separate issues and the economics don't matter?
Go ahead, you're the expert on this.
Well, I think that the things, these initiatives from President Bush have an enormous value if they are pursued to its ultimate and last consequences. If the Doha round succeeds, I think that it will be very well established that there was a Doha round and a successful Doha round, because the United States championed the round, actually, against the European opposition. Because to be honest, you know, the Europeans had the right rhetoric in 2001, but they did everything to avoid the Doha round. And once the decision was taken, they instilled into the Doha round a number of Trojan horses that could destroy the Doha round along the road. The big question is whether we will finish successfully the Doha round. The question about foreign aid, I think there has been an inflection point. I hope this really establishes a new trend. The new resources for AIDS, and of course the roadmap All of this should help. But again, I think that trying to play with the double standards is not sustainable. I think that there are two things that has to be done. Number one, the world, not only the United States, must recognize that a number of international arrangements have to be changed. To be honest, during the post-World War period, the Security Council did not work, not because of the UN, but because we had a bipolar war, right? That war no longer exists. And yet, the world has not been capable of establishing a new system of international security. I think what we need, you know, is to go back to the drawing board and start discussing how, in the 21st century, the big security issues, the big peace issues, have to be addressed. And I think there's where some sort of leadership we had back in 1945 and in other very important moments in which the American leadership was there, will have to come forward in the coming years.
Can I just make a quick comment? Interesting example of a country I know well, Jordan, where I've lived for most of my adult life. Jordan is seen to be today one of the countries that has come out of the Iraq war situation in relatively good shape, and it hit the jackpot. It got $750 million American dollars. It has a free trade agreement that it got as a reward for the peace agreement of 94 with Israel. It's a WTO association agreement with Europe. And Jordan is seen to be generally a place that has done well. The reality, though, inside Jordan is it's the country that had the most anti-American sentiment, according to the Pew poll. And if you look at that, you say, well, Jordan has done very well economically, and it should be a country that should be very close to the U.S., but the average Jordanian blames the U.S. for supporting a domestic political policy in Jordan in which the government of Jordan suspended parliament for 2 years and used the absence of parliament to push through over 100 temporary laws, which constitutionally it's allowed to do. And so you get this very complex relationship between economic well-being, in which Jordan has done reasonably well. It's growing around almost 5% a year. GDP per capita growth is now double the population growth. It's an amazing success story of contemporary economic management, I think. But there's great political tension and great anti-American sentiment. And I think the lesson of that is that man and woman does not live by bread alone, that you need to look at people's attitudes in a much more nuanced way, that people have economic concerns, they have political concerns, they have legitimacy, legal issues, and they have historical memory and social and cultural values. You have to look at those five elements in the same way as people here in the U.S. If you can't say Americans are happy because they have a national security policy that's making them feel secure, they might feel maybe more secure, but they have concerns about health and education and race relations and other issues. And it's that same nuanced view of people, I think, in the world that the United States needs to take into consideration much more.
Okay, that's a question. Way in the back there, right there.
Mm-hmm. Fred Kemp, The Wall Street Journal, Brussels, Belgium. I wonder if I could speak to my colleague from Corriere della Sera and just ask a really simple question, and that's, how has Iraq changed Europe? Is it more divided because of it? Is it going to come more because of it? The convention would suggest maybe additional divisions now. On top of that, I just want to question your statement that that the difference is in interests and not values. A European Member of Parliament said to me, the real difference is the U.S. has defined its interests and Europe has not, and so Europe doesn't know what its interests are. It's caught up in the euro, in enlargement, in the conventional process, he said, and then he said, Americans aren't from Mars and Europeans from Venus. Americans are from the future and Europeans are from the past or even the present. And his argument was they're caught up in questions of the past and present while America has leapt forward dealing with issues of the future after September 11th.
the point is that Iraq had actually, Europe was like a teenager, okay? I always tell my son that he's an American teenager of European parents that Europe is exactly like him. He doesn't want to go, he doesn't want to do his homework and then he want to go get good grades. Iraq put Europe was a good teenager, okay? We did the Euro and that was an historical, achievement. Please don't underestimate what the common currency was. I mean, it has been since the Middle Age you were not able to travel through Europe with paying with a single money. That was a great historical achievement. But then, that was the level of the economical power. Then we had decide whether to invest this value into the world arena with a common foreign policy, a common defense. Churchill in 1950 proposed a common defense in Europe and it was approved. But why was never implemented? Not because the European are from Venus. First of all, there are many ladies here. Let me state, I have nothing against being from Venus. If you know anything about Greek mythology, Venus always beat the shit out of Mars in every single account that they had, okay? This is just for, I have nothing to be against. Mars lost the Trojan War, okay? Mars lost the Trojan War and Venus won the war. Why was never implemented? I mean, the French fought in Vietnam, the French fought in Algeria, the British fought in Suez, they fought in the Falkland, in the Balkans. The European fought till yesterday. That's not the point. The point is that we didn't fight between ourselves because we had no interest in fighting between ourselves. Give us an interest to do that and we will do it tomorrow. The problem is that I don't buy this Americans from the past and European from the future or the other way around. This is New York. This is a country on foreign relations. Please travel in real America and see if real America is from the past or the future. There are people that believe that the Battle of Armageddon is going to be fought tomorrow, was fought yesterday, and these people are a consistent block of voters for President Bush. The past is a treasure size of this country. This is a country whose strength comes from the past. What we value and appreciate about this country very often comes from the past. And what we don't like about this country, and Americans do not like about this country, often comes from the future. So what I really think is that the war put Europe at their GRE test, okay? They have to take the test. There is no Europe after the war in Iraq. Unless they want, the Europeans are happy with having some economic growth and going skiing in the winter and having a decent life. But if they want to be a player, they have to pass the test. After the common currency, they have to have an army and they have to have a common European policy. Is that coming soon? I don't believe. I don't believe because the difference are as strong. I would just want briefly to address the Ramsfeldian question of the gentleman before. I care very much about the security of the United States because I have two American children and an American wife. But the point is, you have to talk strategy. You have to talk strategy. Is being unilateral make this country safer? No, because you can win all the little wars with the little guys. And you can humiliate Europe. And then one day, in 25 years, in 30 years, you're going to face China. What are you going to do? You're going to invade China? You have military people in this room. Ask them if they want to invade China in the next generation.
Okay, here we go. Right here, the gentleman with the glasses. We'll come to you next after that.
There are two.
Two of them. Okay, sorry.
Dick Longworth, Chicago Tribune, Chicago. The U.S. has unquestioned military superiority, and according to the National Security Strategy, we intend to hold on to it. As Mr. Funabashi said, much of the world is content with this to the degree that this is used as a stabilizing status quo power to bring peace around the world. But what I'm hearing are a couple of things, certainly growing resentment, great doubt about American double standards, great questions about how this power is to be used, coupled with a sort of a self-denigration, the idea that the Europeans might be teenagers, the fact that the French army is good for a laugh. Are we working ourselves towards a situation where there might be some sort of concerted or definite opposition to the United States? I get the feeling the world is just now coming to terms, trying to figure out what's going on in the United States. But as Mr. Riotta said, there's an idea now about a European army. Are we sowing the seeds, as empires have in the past, of creating our own opposition?
Well, we saw one example of that in the UN Security Council over a debate over Iraq, where the council moved against the United States, and then we saw the reaction to that. The United States went ahead and did what it intended to do in Iraq anyway, but it's a point very well taken. And ask for rather precise answers now, because there are a lot of questions we want to get to. Does anybody in the panel see a coordinated opposition, per se, being mobilized either on the part of the European Union or in Asia vis-a-vis the United States, or something that's even more trans-regional than that?
I would just say, I don't think it's coordinated, but I think it's rather spontaneous. And I think I don't know if it's opposition, but I think it's a natural kind of resistance to what the United States is doing. And it's at two, well, maybe three levels. One is the actual policies of the U.S. in terms of all of the things we've talked about, the international treaties, what it's doing in the Middle East, et cetera. The second one is about the issue of substance, of style, the manner in which the United States is going around telling the world, you're with us, you're against us. That's terribly offensive to most people around the world, and they will resist it, and they are resisting it. And the third element, I think, is one of, there is a difference of values. And the difference is not values of democracy and freedom, as George Bush has tried to frame it, but it's the values of a collective identity versus an individual identity. You know, if somebody suddenly came through this room streaking naked with green hair on roller skates, you'd see them on David Letterman tomorrow night on TV. They'd sort of get a moment of glory, and people would think it's kind of funny. And if somebody did that in the Middle East or Europe or China, they'd probably be locked up. And there's a very, very big difference in the basic values that define people's identities, how the individual relates to the family, to the neighborhood, to the community. And this difference in values is starting to come into play. So I think at all three levels, there is this spontaneous resistance that we're seeing.
Yoichi? I don't think we will see concerted oppositions to the United States on a grand scale, but I think we may see more subtle a common pressure on the United States and moderate the U.S. behavior and unilateral streaks, particularly from America's trusted allies such as the United Kingdom. In case of North Korean issues, I think the United States simply cannot ignore that common pressure both from Seoul and Tokyo on the United States to moderate their policy towards Pyongyang.
Okay. Question right here, sir. Wait for the microphone.
I'm Bill Franklin from Seattle. I think it's been helpful for you to discuss why Mr. Bush is so unpopular around the world. And I've seen the Pew survey. Can you help us better understand why the people revere the people and respect the people that they do respect? Or even a related question, who should Mr. Bush try to emulate? Who is a good leader in the world today that he should try to be more like?
Or what previous American leaders
told themselves? I'm talking about today, not our memory of some leader from the past, but who today?
Any role model questions?
Yeah. Can I say something? We have to think about polls, because polls can not to be taken religiously, because you answer polls every day. When people in the Middle East or when people in Europe answer a poll saying, are you in favor against the United States? Are you a favorable view of the president? They know that they are casting a vote that lasts one day. This doesn't reflect their attitude for life or yesterday. They will simply say, we don't like what these guys are doing. or the way they are doing, or they want like to put some sort of break. I don't think that this is cast in iron and will last forever. And there are tremendous leaders in these countries that still have a lot of appreciation all over the world. I've seen pictures of Bob Kennedy in the street demonstrations in Europe and alongside with Che Guevara, and I was wondering about the confusion, but still, they were there. I mean, it's not the, I think that people are very much tuned in what people are doing. If President Bush will get any kind of agreement in the Middle East, you will see that changing, or is that, or should Iraq be put on a better track soon, you will see the polls turn around. I don't see that forever.
He has two presidents. He should, he at least he wants to emulate the least, Bush Senior and Clinton. And I think he really should be free from this obsession, once and after all.
Well, I might just put in a comment or two. One of the things that we saw in the last several months, I think, was a really, not a failure, a poor performance by key leaders. Now, we've already heard a lot about George Bush, certainly the behavior and the rhetoric, quite as whatever you might think of the policy and how he was gratuitous for the administration, many of the comments. You saw it in Jacques Chirac, in the absolute statements and positions that he was taking. And you saw it in Gerhard Schroeder going back to the election campaign last fall, when he was, with the case of political opportunism, he raised the Iraq issue. Now, when you have three leaders like that, all going off the tracks rhetorically and in terms of behavior, you don't have much hope. Tony Blair, I think, probably stuck to the best line, stayed on the rails. But I think it was probably a unique experience that three leaders of this stature, three of the most important countries in the world, misplayed their cards. But that's a personal comment. Let's go right back over there.
Hi, Jim Dalton, Los Angeles. Let me raise a point and ask you to comment. Isn't there a fundamental difference in the sense of urgency in dealing with weapons of mass destruction and the potential to be in terrorist hands in this country as compared to the people we've heard here today and Thursday? I mean, it's American embassies in Africa, it's our ships in the Gulf, it's our people in Saudi Arabia, and it's 9/11. And we have a sense of urgency that I don't think is shared by our friends and allies.
Anybody want to comment on that?
Well, no, I think that after 9/11, the sense of urgency was universal. Everybody felt threatened. Everybody saw in TV what happened here. I think the question is how to come into terms with that new reality. And I would say that even not sophisticated people tend to believe that in order to fight terrorism and other forms of international criminality, you need international cooperation. Mm-hmm. I worked a lot with this country to fight drug trafficking. And for many years, you know, the US was saying one thing and Mexico was saying another thing. The US was saying, well, you know, we have a drug problem because you are a place of transit for the supply. This is a supply problem, so you fix it. And we Mexicans were saying, well, you know, we have a problem and a very severe problem because of you. If you didn't consume these drugs, the Colombians will not be using our territory to introduce the drugs. I think the two sides were wrong. Mm-hmm. We had to recognize that this was a global problem, an international problem, and that only if we came together and cooperate with whatever means we could have, we will have the possibility of a solution. And I think it's the same with terrorism. If you don't have international cooperation, you will not solve the problem. I don't think combating terrorism only implies having the biggest military power in the world. I didn't see these fanatics using weapons of mass destruction to cause the damage that was caused here and to kill all those innocent people. all they used were two things, you know, little knives and the will to be killed themselves. So people don't understand, you know, all this rhetoric about weapons of mass destruction and combating terrorism. I think that there's a problem, a very serious problem of communication here.
Just one point there. If you look at Northern Ireland, you know, Northern Ireland had a terrible modern history of terrorism, but it seems to have stopped, at least for the moment. And the reason it stopped is because all the concerned parties got together, did an intelligent analysis, looked at the underlying problems, brought in all of the parties, separated legitimate from illegitimate grievances, separated political resistance from criminal terror, addressed the root causes, and the terror has stopped in Northern Ireland. So I would argue that the level of analysis in the United States about the causes and the meaning of terror and the aims of people who do it really has to rise to a much, much higher level of maturity and sophistication and realism. I think one of the great catastrophes of intellectual effort of our days has been the American response to terror. It's been really an intellectual and a political catastrophe, and I would argue that Americans are probably much less safe now than they were 5 or 3 years ago. And I think the people like the council yourselves here should really do a lot more to challenge the established powers in this country about dealing with this issue.
Very briefly, I think you have a point there. I think I do agree with you. I think that the European public opinion do underestimate the sense of insecurity that the people in this country have. Don't blame them, because they are not alone. The Democratic Party did exactly the same mistake at the midterm election. So it's difficult to, I mean, and they're living in this country. I blame the media. I blame I blame people that do my job, because I, for example, fail to convey the sense of anxiety that people do have in this country. But I agree with you.
Okay, we're coming to the end of our session. What I'd like to do is take a number of questions, state them briefly, and then we'll parcel out some quick answers. The gentleman here has been very patient.
Richard Brown from Philadelphia. There's one word that I've not heard mentioned in this panel, and that's the word Islam. In the United States, there seems to be a perception among a lot of people that Islam is equated with terrorism. And in some of the statements of Islamic clerics abroad, they talk about Islam versus the West. What is the view in other parts of the world about the effect of Islam on the present security problem?
Okay, next question. Let's go right here, sir.
Isaac Shapiro, Gaden Arps. I've been living in Paris for the last 13 years. I have a question to ask the panel, but especially Mr. Khouri, is that right? And also a question you should ask yourselves. Jean-François Revel just published a book in March called The French Anti-American Obsession, in which he says that America for the French has for a long time been what he calls a bouc émissaire, the scapegoat. And you know, Carl Jung, who was not an American, who was a European, said that the capacity for inner dialogue is a touchstone to outer objectivity. So I ask you, are you not, to some extent, making us a scapegoat for your own problems?
Okay. Third question, all the way back there.
I'm William Altman from Houston. One of the things you mentioned in Jordan is that there's some anti-Americanism due to the fact that U.S. is perceived as supporting a government that pursued bad policies. And in Iraq and Afghanistan, although for obviously extreme reasons, we've gone to the steps of overthrowing governments that were extremely unjust and cruel to their own people. My question is, why does the U.S. not get any credit for this type of action that overthrow such bad governments, when in fact the support for such governments seems to be the source of much anti-Americanism?
And we'll take one more. We'll go for it. The lady right here.
Diana Lady Dugan, CSIS, Washington and San Diego. A little different tack. There's been an awful lot of attention in the last 2 years of the corporate corruption in the United States. And my question to the panel is the degree to which there is a serious long-term view that somehow we are in fact becoming a more corrupt private sector, and how would they compare institutionalized corruption in so many other countries as opposed to the United States?
Okay, good question. Let's start the parsing. First of all, Islam. The name wasn't raised specifically. It is there. Do other cultures share this concern?
No, I think there's a lot in your statement and in your concern. I think there is a real problem there. But the question is how you tackle that problem. Do you tackle that problem through the wolf of wheat approach of inverse domino effect? Do you really think that you are going to democratize the Islamic Arab worlds and make them modern societies by this means? I doubt it very much. I think the strategy is wrong. I think the right strategy is engagement. I think putting things to an extreme, you know. I think it's still truth what Compton said in the middle of the 19th century when he was arguing for the repeal of the corn laws. And there is free trade is about diplomacy. I think that's the answer. Engagement, interdependence, a trade, promoting openness. And then in a few decades, the problem will be solved. And I think the best example we have here is Cuba. You know, for 40 years, the strategy has been isolation, which is a fallacy because Cuba has never been isolated. That's the American vision, you know, and the Cuban resource or Castro's resource. We have been isolated because of the United States, and that's why we are poor. And that's why we cannot be free. Of course, that's a lie. But he has had this big excuse. I wonder for how long Castro would be there if the United say, okay, we are open for trade. I don't think it would last more than 6 months. And I think that's also part of the answer in the Islamic Arabic countries. Let's trade more. Let's have more openness. And little by little, the culture, not only the economic culture, but fundamentally the political culture, is going to change.
And we must remember the Islam is more than the Arab world. So we've seen examples of that happening.
Yeah, but I'm just speaking about Arabic Islamic world. I think you must establish a difference. Yes. Indonesia, other Islamic, Bangladesh, which is the second largest, is different.
Johnny, comment about Revel, French anti-American obsession, as a good Italian.
The leader is not always loved. I mean, you're an audience of leaders in your own job and communities, and you know what I'm talking about. The leader, Rome, wasn't exactly loved. The teacher is not always exactly loved. So some sort of resentment comes with the territory of being the leader. And the United States is the world leader. And I think it's a good thing that he's a world leader compared to other possible leaders in the next future. The problem is that what kind of leader the United States wants to be, because it's easy for the United States to keep going on as the leader in the next future, but is it enough for this country to rule the world, like to occupy Iraq and then sort of let the mess sort out a little bit? I don't think that this is like the real national security strategy that pays off for this country. If the United States is really the leader, it has to address like the generation of President Roosevelt or President Truman managed to do, meaning not only solving the current crisis, but to establish an international framework that is sustainable for a generation. And that's what I hope that the United States is able to do. And if the United States wants to do this, then Europe will cooperate. I'm sure that, for example, there are many, many forces in Latin America and in the Islamic world that are ready to cooperate with that.
Rami, you want to comment the quick question that was back there about the U.S. and the dictators and Horton Jordan?
Yeah, and also the scapegoat question is an important one. I think there is an element of people criticizing the U.S. because it's easier to criticize the U.S. than criticize your own autocratic regime. But I think you shouldn't underestimate the real impact on the daily lives of hundreds of millions of people in the Middle East over the last two generations, the real impact of American policies directly and indirectly on those people. And I think it's a combination of those two things that we have to look at. What is the impact of American policy in terms of Arab-Israeli, in terms of domestic Arab regimes, economic issues, and what is the response of people in the Middle East? Because we're in the Middle East, people criticize three things: their own governments, Israel, and the United States, and the European colonial tradition to an extent. And I think you only hear the American criticism. You don't hear the other criticisms, but we make all those criticisms. So I think you need to get a better nuanced understanding or perception of what is actually being said by Arabs, because we're not only criticizing the U.S. and Israel, but also our problems. The question there, yes, tyranny and totalitarianism are problems in the modern in the modern Middle East. But in the eyes of the average person in the Arab world, and that's the area I know best, I would say that the combination of, again, the direct and indirect impact of American policies and American-Israeli policies is seen by the average person to be a bigger problem than local autocrats. And this may seem strange to you, but I think this is the only way I can explain it. So the answer is to fight Arab tyranny and to fight global hegemonic neo-colonial exercises by powers from abroad. And the Chinese had the best saying for this during the first Gulf War in 1991. They said, we have the problem is very simple. You have a little hegemon in Iraq and you have a big hegemon in the United States. And they're two hegemonic problems. And I think we've got to fight them both.
Finally, Yoichi, this interesting question at the end. It's a subject for a whole panel on its own. The extent to which the scandals, the excesses of American corporate practice are large, big examples of this, will tarnish the image, one of the ideals or values of America as perceived from abroad. From a Japanese point of view or an Asian point of view, is this a factor in the international scene?
Well, there's no question that many people in Asia, whether Indonesian business tycoons, overseas Chinese business, Japanese top executives, banking, security, have been watching this, you know, Tyco and Enron and Arthur Anderson gleefully. When particularly they have been very much resentful of being lectured, preached by the American officials about their crony capitalism, particularly when that Asia was hit hard in that Asian economic crisis and crises. But at the same time, I think they have been, including myself, have been very much impressed with the way that those problems have been addressed with legislators and SEC officials and media are trying to address and redress that the problems in such a decisive and quick manners. So, you know, all that market is corruptible, but at least that in the United market, more oxygen.
Well, thank you very much. I want to thank our panel for their participation today. And also...